A ver, valiente. Ah, ya.
Do I have to do something with the microphone?
Ah, okay.
And then you can speak. Okay.
Okay, sí, yeah, okay. Okay, building Wunderlist, lesson learned. In this talk, I'm going to talk about the things that we learned during the construction of the building of Wunderlist, things that I think are really useful, or some tips, or some things that we thought that was useful to share. So yeah, it's more or less this talk. First, six Wunderkinder and Wunderlist. First, Wunderlist. Wunderlist is a productivity app. It's a to-do list app. Probably is the most important productivity app. We have more than 6 million users. And so basically, this productivity app, this application, Wunderlist, is based on list, and every list has a lot of tasks. So you can include, you can add tasks. And so you can also share lists with your friends or with your workmates. And also you can do with different stuff with the tasks. For instance, you can add reminders, you can split your task in different subtasks, you can add notes, you can even upload attached files. Also, every task you have like a message system that where you can speak with your friends or with your coworkers. And yeah, so basically this is Wunderlist. Wunderlist is free, but also we have a pro version where you can do a lot of unlimited things. Like for instance, you can attach files, you can send unlimited messages, or yeah, this also you can choose different backgrounds, etc. And Six Wunderkinder is the company behind Wunderlist. We are based in Berlin. We are going to open an office in San Francisco really soon, and we are around, I think, 50 people. And we are people from different parts of the world, from Italy, from Spain, from India, Germany, of course, USA. So yeah, it's really funny work there. And these two guys, they are my workmates in the Android team, so we are three. I'm César Valiente. I'm from Madrid, from Spain. I started with Android in 2009 with the G1, and then, but when I was working in Madrid, I was working as Java developer, Java backend developer. But then I wanted to work completely focused in Android. So then I moved to Amsterdam. I was working there in Ice Mobile Agency. This is probably the most important mobile agency based in Amsterdam. And after that, I really like the startup behavior, the startup atmosphere, or the possibility to work in your own product and not in third-party products. So then I moved to Berlin, and then I started in June 2012, and then we built Wunderlist 2, and until now. So this is my Twitter account, G+, and GitHub, etc. So we are going to start with maybe this is the most bold topic is databases. So operating modes. Okay, so we have, probably you know, GetReadable database and GetWritable database. And you can think of, GetReadable database, if I use this function, then I can use the database just in readable mode. And if you use GetWritable database, I can use this database I can read and write. But the thing is, not if you don't have any problem with storage. So, for instance, you can create, you have a space enough size to store different tables or insert new elements in your database. When you use GetWritable database, you are going to have you have the possibility also to write in the database. So, yeah, and if you have any problem with the storage, then sadly you just can't read. And the mainly different part of that is that the get writable database mode, if you use this mode, then will call to uncreate, on open, and upgrade callbacks. This is really important because sometimes you have to use that. Of course, both methods may take long time, the same with all networks and database stuff. So avoid the main thread. You have to manage your multi-threading stuff with whatever you want to do. Transactions. This is a really tricky thing. An upgrade executes its own transaction. What does it mean? It means that all the changes that you are performing in your an upgrade method, they are going to be committed in just one transaction. So here you have to be really careful with the exception, because if something happens, then your changes, they are not going to be committed. So you are going to have a really big rollback. So I think it's much better if I show you this example. You have an upgrade, so this is a really easy one. We check the different database version, blah, blah, blah. We have the case 2, then we do whatever we want to do, and then in the case 3, we do another thing. But then imagine that you have here an exception. Then, because you have an exception, your changes that you thought that was commit in the previous case, they are not going to be commit, so you are going to have a really big rollback. So, yeah. But you can think that because transaction can be nest, so you can have different children, different transactions inside of the big one. Okay, you can think I can split the different transactions so per case, and then, for instance, in this example, you have the in the case 2, you begin transaction, do something with the transaction, and then commit your changes. So until here is really good. So you think that everything has been commit. And then in the case 3, we have another transaction, we do something, but then you have an exception. So you probably thought that your changes that were commit previously are commit, but no. If you have here a transaction, because they are the children of the big transaction, your changes, they are not going to be commit. You can catch the exception, and also you can, for instance, in the catch exception, you can use set transaction successful, and then your changes, they are going to be commit. But probably you don't want to do that because I think you have an exception here on upgrade method, is because something wrong has happened. So you can, it's not a good idea to commit your changes. Simple queries. I think it's much better to use a single query for a string, for blob, for long, etc., instead making a row query. This is because simple query for long string, etc. This is the syntax is easier than using a row query. As you can see here, for instance, we have two methods. With one is using the simple query, and the other one with the row query. So in the first one, we compile our statement, and then we execute the query and we return the result. And in the other one, so this one is easy, and then in the other one, we create the query, we execute the query, then we have the cursor, we have to iterate through the cursor, then we have the data, and then close, and then return. With maybe small amount of data, or simple data, or simple queries, the difference is not really big. In fact, it's more or less the same. But if you have a table or a database with a lot of tables, a lot of amount of data, or even if you are using a really complicated query with subqueries or inner joins, outer joins, etc., here the performance is much better in the simple query for long, string, etc. Okay, so we are going to pass to Android internals, so different things. A syntax and multithreading. This probably you know, probably not, I don't know. But this is a thing that when we ask in interviews, a lot of people don't know about this stuff, and it's important. So before Android 1.6, all the syntax were executed serially. Starting 1.6 until Android 3.0, then they change to instead using serially, they use a pool of threads, so allowing tags in parallel. But then, starting in Android 3.0, Google came back to an execution of a single thread. I think this is much better because allow us as developers, as engineers, manage or all of multi-threading stuff. Instead that the operating system manage everything. Okay, some tips: try to update the UI as soon as possible. Of course, this is a super common thing, doing background on post execute. But I mean, for instance, imagine this case that we have we are retrieving data from a REST endpoint, and then we pass the data and then doing background, and then we want to store the data in the database. I think here it's much better if you notify the user, we refresh the UI, then and the other things, the database stuff, is doing under the hood in another thread. So the user, I think it's much better for the user because the user has just pressed a button and then he has the feeling that, whoa, this is super fast. But is under the hood is creating another thing, the database stuff. So but it's much better. So always you can try to update the UI as soon as possible. Use a syntax just for short time operation. For instance, in the previous talk, Matthias was talking about this also a syntax. This is a super, super easy thing to perform multi-threading stuff. And in fact, Google recommends use this just for short time operations. For longer operation, also to have more control over your multi-threading stuff, you have to use, you have Java util concurrent package, and then you have executor, thread pool executor, future stack, etc. Also, you can use a lot of different third parties libraries, like for instance Java Rex or broadcast receivers. Broadcast receiver. This is important. Also, this is a thing that sometimes we forget about that. And broadcast receiver is just valid for the during the duration of the on receive. Once the on receive is finished, then the broadcast receiver has finished. So it's dead. This is important because imagine you want to perform something in the on receive and then you create a thread or something. And after the thread is finished, you want to come back to on receive to a callback or something like that. But then when you are going to come back, you realize that your broadcast receiver has dead. So you are going to have a Java null exception probably. So be careful with these things. Local Broadcast Manager. Since the Android support library version 4, we have the Local Broadcast Manager. That is really, really interesting thing because it allows you to give us more a new layer of security. All the your broadcast messages that are sending using this Local Broadcast Manager or everything regarding broadcast receiver using this, they are just for your package, for your application. This is really important because then your data is not exposed to other applications. Then because you know that we have in Android several Android application malware that try to exploit our data. So this is a really good thing to have maybe a bit more of security. If you are not using the support library version 4, you have also another approximation. It's it's set package, but it's just in ice cream sandwich. So you can use this thing also, but just starting in ice cream sandwich. We have here an example. So for instance, this is super easy example. So we have here the intent filter, we have the on receive, the broadcast receiver, blah, blah, blah. And then we have to use one of those. This is this is not real. Using the Android support version 4, we have the local broadcast manager, get instant, and then we register the receiver. And using the normal way, we have just the register receiver. So here is the tricky thing, the normal with the local broadcast manager stuff. We have the broadcast intent, so this is going to be the message, and then we use the local broadcast manager send broadcast. So when we use this thing, our message is going to send, but just for our application, not for the rest of the Android operating system. And in the normal way, if you are using ice cream sandwich onwards, you can use the set package in the message in the broadcast intent, and then you can set your package and then send the broadcast message. Service. This is also a thing that sometimes we forget. In fact, when we do interviews, a lot of people they think that the service running they have their own thread, but this is not true. Service running the main thread of his hosting process, so in the UI thread. So if we want to perform something long operation or different stuff inside of the service, we have to manage our own multi-threading stuff. So yeah, keep in mind this thing. Also, you know that with services, we have two ways to use services. We can start a service, and we can bind different elements to a service, and then communicate through, with the service. For instance, we can bind application, the application, we can bind activities, etc. So if using the first thing, when the service has finished, it has to finish itself, because then the service is like a zombie. And if we use in the other way, so binding the different activities or application to the service, then we have you have to keep in mind that when the last element has unbind, then the service is destroyed. If you don't want to manage your own multi-threading stuff, because maybe it's complicated, or maybe you don't, because yeah, a lot of reasons, we have intent service that are handled on a single worker thread. This is a super easy way to have a service that manages their own thread, his own thread. So the only thing that we have to do is call super to the giving a name of for the intent service, and then override the unhandle intent. And here is where we create all the stuff that we want to do. For instance, we at Sigwunderkinder, we use this intent service for all regarding files. So when we upload a file or we download a file, we are using intent service. I think it's a really good way to manage the service with multi-threading without worry about all the multi-threading stuff that it can give us problem. Notifications. As you know, we have different notification styles. Before Ice Cream Sandwich, like notifications, they were super, super boring. And starting Ice Cream Sandwich and also in Jelly Bean, etc., we have different and cool things. For instance, the Ice Cream Sandwich, we have the progress bar, and after that in Jelly Bean we have like action, like buttons, no? We have the image, we have a notification that can be expanded. But here the most important thing is respect the version styles. It's really important that, for instance, for a user that is using like a gingerbread version or something, if we want to show something like a super cool notification, it's like weird, no? It's weird for the user, because the user is not used to this kind of notification. For instance, for a Jelly Bean user, this with notification with buttons, image, etc., is super cool, but for a gingerbread user, it's like, why? So respect the version style. For instance, this is the same with the you know, the Holo Everywhere library. It's more or less the same. It's super nice, the library, but if you are using the Holo them for a gingerbread user, it's like, it's not, I don't know, it's like weird, at least for me. So respect version styles. Be careful updating the notification. If you are using, for instance, notifications, the progress bar in the notification, you have to be careful with the updating time, because it can give you delays. For instance, for us, when we upload or download a file, we saw the progress bar, and then when the user pressed the cancel to cancel the progress, no? At the beginning, we had like a big delays because we were updating the progress bar the whole time. So this is really bad. So try to upgrade the progress bar, not always. Like for instance, 100 progress bar, the normal progress bar, then with like 25%, 50%, 75%, etc. Keyboard issues. Try to use Send as a way to upset the text. Okay, I explained you. You know that we have a lot of manufacturers, Android manufacturers, like HTC, Samsung, Google with Nexus, a lot, Chinese phones, Xiaomi, etc. They manage the keyboards in a different way sometimes. For instance, sometimes that we found that some keyboard, they had it like the accept button. Some of them they use like go, some of them they use enter. So this is a mess because, for instance, the Kindle, it doesn't have, I think, accept or something. So this was a bit tricky because we had to find a way to accept the text using the keyboard, no? And then we decided to use Send because I think 90% of the cases of the keyboards, we always have a Send. So yeah, this is what we did. Also, this is really important. Try to offer always you can a way to accept the text using the UI. This is really important because sometimes you have problems with the keyboard, or for instance, the other day I remember I was using the Nexus 7, the new one, no? And the keyboard was, I don't know what for what reason, but was not responding really good, so it was a mess. But if you give the user a possibility to enter the text using a button, this is much better because then you have to don't worry about all this stuff. We do, for instance, this is a capture of our message system, but WhatsApp, Gtalk, etc., they have the same. Avoid to use edit tests in list views. This is a mess. We have in Wunderlist, like in the left side, a list view with text views that when we do the long press, they change to an edit test to that allow the user to change the name of the list. And then we show the keyboard, but then because you are in the list view with the edit text, sometimes the keyboard is the edit text is hidden by the keyboard, so it's not possible to see the new content. So this is a really mess. We don't know how to solve it. I think probably it's not possible because even with the flags that Android give in the Android manifest, etc., or doing some tricky stuff to moving the keyboard, to moving the list view, it's not 100% of the time is working. So yeah, avoid to use edit text in list view. We do, and it's a mess. Widgets. Okay, we have different widget versions, as you know, before Android 3.0 and after Android 3.0. The main thing in after Android 3.0 was we have list views, etc. So we can, exactly, like a list view. And before, no. So here, the important thing is try to offer the same experience as much as you can to the users. Okay, if the user doesn't have a super cool phone, but it has like a gingerbread project, etc., we have, if it's possible, we have to give the user a way to do more or less the same thing that a user with Jelly Bean or something like that can do. So, for instance, before Android 3.0, in the widget, we have three tasks. So we have a list like here. No, you can see DroidCon Torino. This is a list, and then we have like three different tasks. At the bottom, we have a new line that is. It says like, okay, you have 10 more tasks. So if the user press there, then it's going to the application. And for Android 3.0 onwards, then we don't have that problem. We have the list view, so the user have all the content in the widget. Several widget instances is something really useful. This is completely true. When we start to create the widgets for Wunderlist, we wanted, because it was really useful, that, for instance, here in this example, we saw two different lists, because we thought that was really useful to have like the inbox, one widget with the inbox, another one with your shopping list, another one with the movies that you want to watch, etc. And we thought that was not possible, because you can make the test in the using, for instance, the Facebook widget or the Twitter widget. You can add two different instances in your desk, and then when you navigate through the widget, the state of the both widgets are the same, so they are moving at the same time. So we thought that was not possible. Then we were talking with Nick Butcher, you know, this Google Android advocate based in London, and he told us that was possible, but there was something that the people usually didn't do. So if we could do it, it was something super, super cool. We did it. And the trick here is manage the widgets IDs and save some data, some the state of the widgets in a persistent storage. For instance, what we do is the widget has the different IDs, no? Then we store the list that they are managing. So then when we power off the switch off the phone and then switch on the phone, every widget knows his previous state. So yeah. I think this is really cool for the user, because it can have a lot of different instances of the widget and with different content. Okay, Android and Java. More tips. Cache. People, for instance, for us, for Six Wunderkinder, they send a lot of assignments. We have an assignment for the open position, etc. But a lot of them, they use the database, blah, 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 really good. But they don't use cache. I think this is something super basic, but sometimes maybe we forget about that. But it's really useful, because database operation, there are heavy operations, because in fact, a database is a file, so you have to access to the file, do something, etc., and then retrieve your data, manage your data. But I think using cache is a really good way to have your most used data in the memory, no? For this thing, you can use lists and maps, or also any other dynamic stuff. This is, I think we use the both. But then you have to avoid infinite size. You know that Lisa maps, there are objects that there are they can add dynamically more objects. So we have to follow some strategy to control this, because, for instance, a cache with 1,000 or 2,000 items, this is not really good. So you have to follow some strategy like, I don't know, LRU or another algorithm that you think is cool or is interesting for you. So, for instance, use your sadly your more recent items or the items that you think that are the most useful for the users, etc. So keep it update. This is really important. For instance, imagine that you have a service that is managing your data from a REST endpoint. Then you have your data, you retrieve your data, you parse your data, and then you want to store your data in the database. Okay, but here you have also to upgrade your cache. Because then you can have inconsistencies, no? If you don't have updated the both. Of course, you don't have to update the cache with, I don't know, like another 1,000 items new. So, yeah, the same, no? I was talking before about the follow some strategy. But yeah, keep it at date. For loops. This is a thing that we realized that we didn't know before, and we realized that it's like this. So we have in Java two different for loops, no? The conventional one, so with you know, with the in, blah 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 blah, right, etc. And then the nested one, with is much nicer, so the syntax is much better, and it works really, really good. But think carefully which one are you going to use, because it has performance difference. For instance, we know that this is regarding also is depending of the Java virtual machine, and in Dalvik the performance here is important. Of course, for instance, if you are managing like a list of 100 items, this is not a problem. More or less, the performance is the same. But if you are managing like 1,000, then the next one is the new one is much slower than the old one, the conventional one. And why? This is because they are using an iterator under the hood. So yeah, and other Java virtual machines like the normal Java or like the open source software one, the difference is not like that. But in that big, it is. You can create a test and a script and check it. UI and UX, graphics, assets, etc. You can create a lot of different stuff by code or XML. Of course, you know about that. But really, you can do a lot of really, really cool stuff using code or XML. For instance, and this is really good for two things. The first thing is you are going to avoid like a huge application size application of the application. No, for instance, we at WunderList, I think WunderList now is like 15 megabytes, and mostly is because the backgrounds, the super nice textures, everything, all this stuff. And this also is regarding, so the size here is really important. But also the second thing that is important is because if you are using you are creating your graphics, your stuff, your drawables by code or XML, then also the performance here is much better than the using the graphic design that your designer has given you, etc. For instance, this is a small example. This is a like normal button, etc. But you see that we have rounded borders and with a nice color. Also, you can create like different gradients, no? So for different states of the button, etc. So this is the ABC of Android. So this is a button. This is the selector with different states. But here is the interesting thing is that we can do a lot of stuff for instance, with the layer list, no? We have different items. We have shadows. We have the shape. We have the stroke. We have the rounded corners. So we can do a lot of stuff by code, but XML or code. And I think it's really, regarding the performance, it's really good. And regarding the size of the application, it's amazing. Now, for instance, for WunderList 3, that we are working now in WunderList 3, we release soon, we are changing almost all different patterns that we had, all the super nice textures for this stuff, because we want that the facelift is super, I don't know, super nice, but also is the performance super super faster. Make your own views. This is important. When we were creating WunderList 2 in 2012, we needed a view that was coming from the right side, and then so in the middle, no, and then the user can switch off the slide. And then we didn't have anything, and we didn't have any open source library or something like that. So then we created Sliding Layer Lib, and then when we reached the 1 million downloads of just in Android, then we, as a present for our users, we released this library as open source. So it's in GitHub and was released under Apache License version 2. And since then has been forked and started 100 times. We have a lot of pull requests. We have merged a lot of things. Has been really, really improved by the community. So we are really proud of this library. Now you can find a thin Google release something, but I think it was not open source, but this is much better because now the latest version that you can find in GitHub, it's possible to switch to the top, to the bottom, to the left, to the corner, a lot of stuff. And also you can add, instead different views, you can add a fragment, and the fragment has everything. So yeah, this is really, really good. So yeah, the conclusion here is, if you don't find a view that you need, make your own view. And if possible, release that open source. Okay, Android miscellaneous. So Dash Clock Widget Extension, probably you know, because this was really famous, at least it's just for Jelly Bean. But the Dash Clock Widget was an extension created by Roman Nurik. You know this Google Android Advocate based in New York, I think. This is really, really cool because allow you as developer to show something in your lock screen. For instance, for us, for Wunderlist, we have the name of the list and then the number of tasks that you have to finish. And so, yeah, it's super cool that with a simple site, then you see everything that you have to complete. But this is really important. If you don't have anything to show, then don't show anything, because here the space is really limited. I think we have 2 or 3 rows, so 2 or 3 applications. And so if you don't have anything to show, don't show it. At the beginning, we show even if we had it zero tasks. But then the first day that we released the Wunderlist with this version, Jake Wharton sent us a tweet, and he told us about, okay, guys, this is super cool, but it's much better if we don't have anything in the list, then don't show anything, because then I can check my Gmail, or I can check the weather, etc. And if I have more than 3 or 4, then it's not possible to check it. So, yeah, the conclusion is if you don't have anything to show, don't show it. And thanks, Jake Wharton, for the tip. Rating dialogue. This is something tricky. It's a fact that people usually just rate to give you a bad rating. If the people is happy with your application, it's barely they bought your app as good app. They just use and that's all. But if the people is angry, they are going to give you a really, really bad rate. So when we were with this, I remember one day that our CEO, he came with the idea of having a rating dialogue, and me and my workmates in the Android team, we thought that, whoa, no, this is crazy because the users, they are going to hate us. But yeah, he's the boss, so we added, and man, yeah, we realized that he was completely true. Since then, our ratings, they are much better, not much better. I think the important thing here is that you have a lot of more ratings. The number has been increased a lot, but also the good numbers was much better, because now if you are a user of Wunderlist, for instance, and you have this rating dialogue, and you are happy with the application, then you can rate it. And so yeah, this is work. But here the important thing is, don't force the user to vote. If the user says no, it's not. So yeah, don't force it. Open source. Try to keep up to date about the Android open source world. Of course, you know that we have a lot of different libraries in the Android Android world. Super cool libraries, amazing, like the network libraries, views, etc. So don't reinvent the wheel, because probably it has been invented before. So try to spend a little bit of time looking for the library that you need, and if you find you can collaborate release a new version or something like that. If you can collaborate, I think this is a really good idea. But if you are using open source software, this is really, really important. Be careful with license, because it maybe can give you low problems. This is really serious. Maybe if you are you have a really small application, this is not important, but as a company, this is really, really important. I can talk about this because I know a lot about the open source license, etc. So I'm going to be fast with this stuff. So for instance, we have mainly we have private license. Private license is like probably 90% of Android apps that are private, so they don't share the code. Like for instance, also Windows, Mac OS, iOS, etc. And then we have open source license. Here inside of open source license, we have different groups. We have four groups. So we have reciprocal license. The most important one here is GPL, the GNU GPL. And I'm going to show you this stuff with an example. Imagine that you have your application, your private application, the application that you are developing. And then you found you find a super cool library that is using GNU GPL. You want to use this library into your application, to private application. Then it's mandatory, following the license of the GPL, that you have to release your application under the same terms. So your application cannot be private. We call this license vertical license because it's like a virus. Not in the bad term, of course. For instance, I'm a lover of this license because if you are using this license, it's sure that all the process of the software is going to be always open source. So this is really good for the community, but this is maybe really bad for the companies. This kind of license, they follow that we call copyleft. So you want to know what is copyleft, so search in Wikipedia. We have, after reciprocal license, we have partially closable license. They have like a weak copyleft, like the most important here, like a LGPL or Mozilla license. An example with this license is, for instance, Mozilla license. Mozilla license is in Mozilla Firefox. Imagine you want to create a fork of Firefox, and then you create something cool inside of your fork, and then you want to release your changes, your new Firefox, then here is mandatory that you have to release under Mozilla license, under the same terms, because you are changing the same application. But for instance, in the other way, imagine that you have your private application, and then you find a library that is using Mozilla license. Here is the thing that is the, because this reason is weak copyleft. So you are using, you want to use this library with Mozilla license inside of your private product. Then this license allows you to release your application also under the private license term. So yeah, give you more, I think it's more flexible than the previous one. And then we have permissive license that, yeah, I think most of the open source software is released under this kind of license, like BSD, MIT, or Apache license. And this license, they give you maybe more freedom than the others. The same example, you want to use a library with the Apache license in your product, in your private product. Then here with this kind of license, you can release your application under private terms, so we don't have to release your code, but also gives you the opportunity to follow the chain, no, and follow still releasing your changes, your application under open source software terms. Also here you can think, well, here there are not the, we have a lot of different open source license, a lot, there are a lot, so this is like a mess. But if you are thinking that, okay, I can mix different licenses between them, no, you have to be careful with all the different licenses and the compatibility between them. So you have to read all the terms and check everything if it's possible or not possible. For instance, a simple example, Apache license version 2 is compatible with GPL version 3, but is not compatible with GPL version 2. And also, for instance, well, to finish this thing, we have public domain, that in fact this is not a license. This is something that you can do whatever you want to do with this kind of software, image, etc. Managing several apps. In Wunderlist, we have several apps to manage, like Wunderlist for Google Play, Wunderlist for Google Play for Education, for Amazon App Store, Samsung Store, etc. And it will be a mess if we have to, for instance, to create all our application by hand, and then, for instance, for Google Play, add the Google in-app billing, or for Google for Education, well, the same, but for Amazon App Store, we have to change for Amazon in-app billing, for Samsung the same, etc. So here is where Gradle is working really good. So Gradle is your friend, or not. I say no because, because at least for me, sometimes Gradle is like a mess. So yeah, well, Gradle is evolving super fast. So yeah, it's, in general, it's a really good tool. But well, so Gradle give us the power of flavors. With this example, we can check this thing. This is a simple Gradle script. The important thing here is this node, product flavors, where we have like beta, we have production, we have edu. We can have a lot of different stuff, but it's here where we can add our custom things. For instance, like an extension of the Android manifest, or like a different class with different constants, etc. And then when you build your app using Gradle, you are going to have your different APKs for all the different versions that you have set here in the product flavors. Also, this combining with a continuous integration system, this is really important, because then it's super easy to maintain all these versions, all these different APKs, that without it will be super difficult. And the last one, when I'm attending conference, I sometimes, or well, maybe most of the time, I'm wondering about the tools that that companies use. So I wanted to share with you the tools that we are using. So in our company, we use more tools, but regarding development, and yeah, as software engineers, we are using these tools. So we have we use Atlassian HipChat as our main message system. With this message system, we can have different rooms. For instance, for Android, we have a room for Android, a room for Windows, for Mac, etc. So here is the way to communicate between us. We use GitHub. GitHub, of course. GitHub is amazing. We love GitHub. Everything around GitHub is amazing. The UI, the community around GitHub, the Gist. So it's really good, and it's really easy to manage with the pull request system, because pull request is not a Git thing. It was an invention of GitHub. So yeah, thanks to GitHub for this pull request stuff. We use Wunderlist. I think here is really important. If it's possible for you to use your own application, your own product in your daily work, I think this is really good, because then you are going to learn all the things that the user can need, for instance, or the things also that you thought that were super, super useful, but then you realize when you are working with using your product that this is not good. So we are using Wunderlist as our main backtracking system, and also for almost everything, because for instance, we have like a different list where we have, for instance, the designer create task, and the designers attach files like image or something like that, designs, etc. And then with the message system, we can comment about this task. We can say that if the design is cool or not, etc. Also, with the powerful of Wunderlist and this thing, is that we can assign different tasks to different people. So this is really good, because also we are using Wunderlist for our roadmap, etc. And it's good because I know what my boss wants to, the work that my boss is giving me. You know? And also, we use Dropbox as our main cloud system. So we upload their files, documents, etc. We use Source 3. Well, we use Source 3 and also the terminal. This is up to the software developer. It's also Source 3, if you don't know, it's from Atlassian. It's an amazing tool to manage Git and Mercurial repositories. I recommend that because it's really, really good. We use Android Studio. We use Android Studio since the last year, where Google, I think, released in June in the Google I/O. Then I think after 1 or 2 months, we started to use it. Before we were using Eclipse, and we were really happy with Eclipse, but finally, yeah, we moved to Android Studio because I think it's the way. Probably Google is going to focus more in Android Studio. Yeah, the beginning Android Studio for us was like a mess because it's different, the shortcuts, etc. Of course, you can edit the shortcuts, but all the Gradle system is like kind of mess if you are using Eclipse. But then, well, right now we are really happy with Android Studio. And finally, we use Jenkins. as our continuous integration system. We are really happy with Jenkins because we can, with the Gradle system, we build all the our APKs, all our application. With also Jenkins can create our native builds. Also, we use Jenkins to use to pass our unit tests or robot unit tests, etc. And also, for instance, we have different because Jenkins, well, also Hudson, because Jenkins is a fork of Hudson, give us the possibility to use plugins. And then the plugins, I think, is really useful because, for instance, you can find plugins to check the quality of your code, the, like do create some metrics about the commits, etc. So this is, I think, is a really good thing. And that's all. Questions?
Hello. I wanted to ask you if you have used the headless fragment to manage a sync task.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, well, you mean to the set retain, etc. All
yes.
this stuff, no?
Yes.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you think it is a good pattern to manage a sync task in that way?
Yeah, but also we store some data in a like a persistent storage to and after that we load the data. For instance, with the tablet version, no, because it's the same version, but in tablet because in phones we don't allow the landscape mode, but in tablet yes, but it's the same APK. Yeah, we manage this stuff with the set retain instance and get retain instance, etc. And also we save data also in the memory. Mm-hmm. No, it's super easy. In GitHub, it's just you have to add the so in SourceTree, you can create a new repo, no, and then just the URL of the repo, and that's all. Then you have everything: your branches, your commits, your graphics, etc. Mm-hmm. So it's super super easy. No. SourceTree is a product of a different company.
GitHub.
Yeah. GitHub. But if you want to use GitHub just for free, all your products, all your code, it has to be open source software.
So you paid for it. Basically.
Exactly. In the company, we paid for our private repositories. But if you want to use an alternative to GitHub, to GitHub, is for instance Bitbucket.
Okay,
yeah. So. So, thank you. And by the way, if you are interested in become an Android developer at Sysbundelkinder, we are hiring. So, yeah.